Hello there. Welcome to the Potter's Wheel. Thanks for tuning in. I'm George Osmus. I'm one of the owners of Potter's Wheel Films, and I'll be your host for the next half hour. You know, it's been said that the kingdom of God is a kingdom of opposites. And what is that? What do we mean by that? Well, simply put, we mean that many kingdom principles seem to run counter to natural wisdom. Things like laying up treasure through generous giving or love your enemies. That's always a popular one. But what if I told you that the way up is down, even in the natural world? How can that be, you ask? Well, we're going to take a look at that question on today's episode of The Potter's Wheel. The prophets Isaiah and Jeremiah compared the people of God to clay and spoke of the Lord as a master potter. On its own, clay has no form, no purpose, but in the hands of the master, it can be shaped into a design of his choosing to serve his purpose. He has a number of tools to help him in his work. Chief among them is the potter's wheel. Somewhere in your life, you've probably heard the phrase, immutable laws of physics.
I can't change the laws of physics.
There's a law of gravity, for example, that basically says that things that weigh more than air will fall when dropped. Well, we don't have to be hit on the head with a falling apple to know that, but there is another law, a law of aerodynamics, that overrides the law of gravity and allows us to fly around in airplanes. So there's this thing called lift that is generated by airflow over the surface of the plane's wings. And airflow is driven by forward motion, or airspeed. The faster the airspeed, the greater the lift. And at slower airspeeds, lift is reduced. Well, in a steep climb, the airflow is disrupted and the lift is reduced. That produces what is called a stall condition. And if a pilot doesn't recover from a stall condition, well, that plane is going to crash. Now, today's clip is from the 2019 film Midway, starring Ed Skrein, Patrick Wilson, Woody Harrelson, directed by Roland Emmerich and written by Wes Took. In the clip, we're going to see two pilots who are facing stall conditions and what they did to get out of it. Take a look. See, the way up is down. You get it now, right? So both planes were in a stall condition. The one who put his plane into a dive was able to recover, but the one who thought he could climb out of it crashed and, well, died. Which goes to show you folks, life isn't a fairy tale, and forgiveness doesn't always mean you get a second chance. So let's interpret the symbols from our clip. The aircraft carrier represents the church, or the body of Christ. Pilot number one represents a mature disciple of Christ, while pilot number two, the one who crashed, represents an immature believer. So let's talk about what's going on in the clip. Well, first of all, the aircraft carrier is not up to speed, right? For the church to be at her full power, she must love God with all of her heart, mind, soul, and strength. That's the first commandment. God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him, and those dominated by the natural mind think that reward is money, cars, homes, maybe fame and power. But you want to know what the real reward is? I believe it's the same reward that he offered Abraham. He said, I am your exceeding great reward. If we draw near to him, he will draw near to us. And being near to God is much safer than being away from him. Don't ask me how I know. Apathy, complacency, and a casual approach to God are deadly. James said, for let not that man, the one who prays and doubts, suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. Lukewarmness made Jesus declare to the Laodicean church that he would vomit them out of his mouth in Revelation 3:16. Let's not forget, folks, it is the church's primary responsibility to make disciples, not believers. Jesus in the Great Commission said, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age. And we have always been under the commandment of heaven to make disciples. So why does the American church want to so often settle for just making believers? Only disciples can carry on the work of Jesus in the earth. And the Church of Jesus Christ is called to be the one standing for truth and righteousness. How can we hope to do that without creating disciples who crucify their old nature and have learned to walk in the Spirit? Ephesians 4 says it plainly, the fivefold ministry was given to the body for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry. And what is the work of ministry? Well, that answer is different for each one of us. Broad brush, it means to answer the call of God on your life. Your call is something that will be unfolded to you as you seek the Lord, develop your relationship with him in the prayer closet, and faithfully obey him in the little things. Paul asked the Romans, how shall they preach unless they are sent? An apathetic, compromising, lukewarm church can't send anybody out prepared to minister the true gospel with anything approaching effectiveness. Who can? Churches that love God with all their heart, mind, soul, and strength, and who love their neighbor as themselves. Check yourself before you wreck yourself, church. You can't give to others what you don't first possess yourself, and you cannot impart the life of God into spiritually dead people if it's not abounding in you first. So, back to the clip. Both pilots faced the same conditions. Pilot number one, remember, representing the mature disciple, he recognized the danger immediately and he took the proper corrective action. He put his plane into a dive to build up airspeed and pulled out of the dive once he was going fast enough to maintain flight. Pilot number two, on the other hand, remember, representing the immature believer, also recognized the danger immediately, but he did what was right in his own eyes. He kept pulling back on the stick to force the plane to climb. That increased the angle of attack and caused greater disruption of the airflow over the wings. In other words, he made it worse. So what was the difference between the two? I believe maturity level. Pilot number one was mature enough to overrule his fear and his natural instincts. Pilot number two, his immaturity caused his fear and natural instincts to overrule his training. Similarly, the disciple knows how to continually humble himself under the mighty hand of God. That's pilot number one putting his plane into a dive. But the believer, ruled by his feelings and his natural thinking, keeps doing what is right in his own mind. And that would be, of course, pilot number two crashing into the ocean. So what happened after the stall? Let's look at the mature disciple, pilot number one. Well, he tried to warn his buddies back on the carrier, and that worked out about as well for him as us trying to tell the American church about the danger that she's in. And what do I mean by that? Well, church, we are not here to consume the blessings of God upon our flesh. We are not here to live our best life now. We are here to serve the purposes of God. We are here to preach the gospel. We are here to bring others out of darkness. We are here to oppose and destroy the works of hell, or to put it another way, to follow Jesus, because that's what he did during his entire earthly ministry. We need to own the fact that the current state of the nation is the fault of the church in many ways. We need to stop quoting 2 Chronicles 7:14 and start living it. We need to turn from empty, dead religious rituals that have a form of godliness but deny His authority over our lives. We need to repent of offering Him half-hearted, double-minded, lukewarm worship that we fit into our schedule. We need to stop acting like He is some genie in a bottle who exists to satisfy our every corrupt, wicked, carnal desire. We need to develop a genuine, wholehearted prayer life whose goal is to see His kingdom, righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit come and His will be done. We need to start living the seek first the kingdom commandment from Matthew 5. We need to grow up out of our perpetual baby state where salvation is all about me going to heaven and missing hell and becomes about doing the work God has called us to do. So what about the guy who crashed, pilot number 2, again representing the immature believer? He was run over by the carrier, which, as we said before, represents the church. Too many times the people of God wind up shooting their wounded. Now, we all mess up from time to time, even willfully. I mean, let's be serious, let's be real about it. Fornication and adultery, they're not mistakes or accidents. You intended to sleep with that person that you're not married to. Don't ask me how I know. Sin is serious business and needs to be dealt with, no question. But we can't apply a one-size-fits-all approach to it. I suggest the church's response is dependent on the person's attitude, because I see plenty of evidence in Scripture that God's response to sin in the lives of His people is driven by that. Is the person repentant and confessing it as sin? Then our response needs to be mercy, forgiveness, and restoration. Are they rebellious and trying to justify or rationalize their behavior? Then we need to provide correction, more correction, and in extreme cases where multiple corrective counsel has been repeatedly rejected, excommunication. Now, that pilot had undoubtedly been trained how to recover from a stall, but instead of following his training, he went his own way. He did what was right in his own eyes. Now, that phrase appears often in the Bible. Ask yourself, how many times has it worked out well for those who practiced it? I'll give you the answer, never. This is a manifestation of pride, folks. Pride is trusting your own thoughts, ideas, perceptions, plans, and schemes over those of God. So why is pride dangerous for a Christian? Well, as we all know, pride caused Lucifer's fall, according to Isaiah chapter 14, verses 12 through 14. How you are fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. How you are cut down to the ground, you who weakened the nations. For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation, on the farthest sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. The Bible is full of verses warning about the dangers of pride. Let's take a look at a few of them. Proverbs 11:2, when pride comes, then comes shame, but with the humble is wisdom. Proverbs 16:18, pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. Proverbs 13:10, by pride comes nothing but strife, but with the well-advised is wisdom. Pride is the root of almost every offense. Did you ever think about that? For example, somebody disagrees with one of your pet doctrines. I mean, think about what happens when you bring up touchy subjects like tongues or the timing of the rapture. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, yeah, they'll know we are Christians by our love, right? What if the service takes a direction you didn't feel like going? I mean, I've even heard stories about church splits coming from disagreements over the color of the carpet. Are you kidding me? Examples abound. I mean, examine some offenses that you have taken in the past yourself. If you're honest, you'll find your own pride buried down deep on the inside of it. What's the danger of offense? Offense unchecked or not properly dealt with will lead to broken fellowship, church splits, whole new denominations, as if we didn't have enough of those already. You know, the Bible says that God resists the proud, And without going into the details, I've been through a period in my life where my pride ruled my roost, and I know what it means to live with him resisting me. I gave up about a decade of my life where I could have been serving God and growing in the faith. Instead, that time was used to serve my flesh while my faith atrophied. It was the darkest period of my life, but it serves now as a reminder of what happens when my pride gets in the way of his will for my life. By now, you're hopefully thoroughly convinced of the deadliness of pride. So what can we do about it? What's the antidote? Well, we'll talk about that right after these words from Potter's Wheel Films. They say a picture is worth 1,000 words. So what do you think 1,000 pictures would be worth? At Potter's Wheel Films, we want to help you find out. We're a Christian film company. We make movies that preach the gospel, demonstrate biblical life principles, and encourage other believers in their faith walk. We're also here to help Christian churches, ministries, performing artists, and others with your digital media needs. We're ready to take on any size project, from a 30-second teaser spot to a 30-minute TV show and beyond. We want to put our tools and talent to work for you to expand your audience and increase your ministry's impact on the community. Contact us at 217-494-7798 or by email at potterswheelfilms@gmail.com and let us open the world of digital video media to you. Welcome back. I promised before the break that we would talk about antidotes to pride. Without any further ado, let's jump right into it. The first antidote to pride I want to talk about is thankfulness. Many moons ago, my pastor shared a quote with the congregation out of a book he was reading. I've long since forgotten the name of the book or the author, but the quote is very powerful and has stuck with me for nearly 2 decades. And it's this: "The proud man is seldom thankful, for he rarely gets as much as he thinks he deserves." You know, Romans 1:21, Paul, speaking of a people of reprobate mind, said that although they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were they thankful. He also told the church at Thessalonica, "In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you." You know, I hear Christians all the time talking about they want to know the will of God for their life. Well, that's part of it. In everything give thanks. He says it right there, "For this is the will of God for you." He also said, you know, I want you to pay attention to this. He said, "In everything, not for everything." Obviously, not everything that comes into your life is something to be thankful for, but we can thank God that he always makes a way of escape and helps us endure every trial. Developing an attitude of thankfulness, not just to God, but also to people, is an excellent way to build into ourselves another character trait that serves as an antidote to pride: humility. We've already seen that thankfulness builds humility, but what else helps the cause? Well, it helps to recognize our inherent shortcomings. We are, church, fallen creatures. There is nothing good in us apart from Christ. Before Christ, we were darkness, according to Paul. Now we are light in the Lord. And get what he said there. He didn't say we were in darkness. We were darkness. And now he says we aren't in the light, we are light. And he says that we are light right now. What does now mean in your Bible? You know, Jeremiah said that the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Let me ask you, church, how sure are you of your own motivations? Are you really interested in growing the kingdom of God or your own kingdom? Do you preach Christ from a pure heart, wanting to see lost people get saved? Or do you preach him from selfish ambition, wanting to use his word and his name to line your pockets and make a name for yourself? The world we live in is all about feelings, and we genuinely believe that our perception is reality. We need to come to grips with the fact that human perception is flawed and it is subject to manipulation, being misled, misinformation, or even just flat out wrong. You know, the Lord told Samuel, "For the Lord does not see as man sees, for man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." And Samuel received this instruction when he was looking for the replacement for King Saul. We tend to go for the ones who are beautiful on the outside, but God is looking at character. We choose the wise, the mighty, the noble, according to the opinion of man. But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise, and God has chosen the weak things of the world to put to shame the things which are mighty, and the base things of the world, and the things which are despised, God has chosen, and the things which are not, to bring to nothing the things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. So let's take a look at the second half of the verse from James 4:6 and 1 Peter 5:5. That's the one that starts out, God resists the proud, but he goes on to say, but gives grace to the humble. And Peter goes on from there to say, therefore humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. To fully understand how important it is to have God's grace operating in your life, we have to know what grace is. And I'm sorry about your doctrine, but grace does not always mean unmerited favor. I'll give you an example. John 1:14 says that Jesus was full of grace and truth. So was Jesus full of unmerited favor? Church, I tell you truly, if ever a man walked the earth who merited the favor of God, it was Jesus. So unmerited favor makes no sense in this context. I offer to you an alternate understanding of grace. I define it as a God-given ability to fulfill the work God has for you to do. To test it out, why don't you substitute each definition in place of the word grace to test them out. Let's try John 1:14 first. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of unmerited favor and truth. Yeah, it's kind of like taking a shower with your socks on. It doesn't really feel right, does it? Let's try it the other way. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of a God-given ability to fulfill the work God had given him to do, and truth. Now that fits a little better, doesn't it? Who can deny that Jesus was full of a God-given ability to heal the sick, raise the dead, endure the beating and crucifixion, to take upon himself our sin and bear the wrath of God on our behalf? Let's try James 4:6 again. God resists the proud but gives unmerited favor to the humble. That fits. Let's try it the other way. God resists the proud but gives a God-given ability to fulfill the work God has given them to do to the humble. In James 4:6 and 1 Peter 5:5, either definition will work, but I tend to think that the definition that speaks loudest to you is probably an indicator of your own maturity level. Again, check yourself before you wreck yourself. We're all called to graduate from milk to meat, from being hearers of the word to being doers of it. God loves us at every stage of our development, but he is always calling us higher. He wants his children to fly, church. Isaiah described discipleship this way, but those who wait on the Lord, that's your disciplined followers, shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Does anyone deny that living as a genuine Christian in this world requires strength, requires moral fortitude? The God of this world, the spirits of this age, are constantly tempting us. Our flesh is endlessly trying to have its way. Both are relentlessly looking for opportunities to turn us from the path of righteousness, to disqualify us from fulfilling the call of God on our lives. We need his strength to resist temptation and to keep our own fallen nature submitted to the lordship of Jesus Christ. You're going to hear me talk a lot about fulfilling the call of God, and that is because I believe that there is no higher goal that any believer can set for himself. The thing about the call of God is it's always going to involve other people. Modern poets have said, no man is an island. God himself said, it is not good that man should be alone. Whatever God has called you to do, he doesn't expect you to do it alone. We credit King David's son Solomon with building the first temple in Israel, but he didn't do it alone. 1 Kings chapter 6 recounts the building of the temple and says over and over, he built this and he built that. Well, you don't have to be head cashier at the Walmart to figure out that King Solomon had help building that temple. He had woodworkers, stonemasons, artisans, craftsmen of all kinds working for 7 years and change to make the vision a reality. Humility will make building the personal, business, and ministerial relationships that we need in order to fulfill the call of God so much easier. I might even go so far as to say it's impossible to build and maintain those relationships without it. Well, we've covered a lot of ground here, but before we close in prayer, let's review some of the high points of our time together. First of all, the way up is down. When we do what is right in our own eyes, when we get caught up in our own works and self-effort, we're headed for a crash every time. Pride is deadly. It led Lucifer into rebellion and got him and a third of the angels cast out of heaven. We are not immune from its consequences. Thankfulness is a powerful antidote to pride. It helps build humility into our character. Make it a point to express gratitude, not only to God, but to the people He has put into our lives. God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that He may exalt you in due time. We can't hope to fulfill the call of God on our life without His grace operating in our life, and that won't happen if we're caught up in carnal pride. Amen. Let's close in prayer, folks. Father God, we enter Your gates with thanksgiving and Your courts with praise. We are so thankful that while we were yet without strength, You sent Jesus to die for the ungodly. For it is by faith in His death, burial, and resurrection that we are declared righteous in Your sight and welcome in Your presence. Help all of us, Lord, to continue to put off the old man and to put on Christ, to continue to press on toward maturity in the faith. By Your Spirit, Father, put to death the deeds of the flesh and help us to graduate from milk to meat, where we say with You that our meat is to do the work You have called us to do. Thank You for the promise of Your Spirit who works in us both to will and to do for Your good pleasure. Help us, Lord, to overcome the weakness of our flesh and to walk in Your victory over the temptations of the wicked one. May our lives testify of Your grace, mercy, and glory, and may we see Your kingdom come and Your will be done in our lives on the earth as it is in heaven. God bless. Thank you.